Good morning, students. We will be starting our lecture on electrostatics. So this is basically the second lecture on electrostatics. But before we move on to the second lecture of electrostatics, as we'll do a basic recapitulation or the recap of what we have learned in our previous lessons or the previous lecture that sir took the other day. So basically, we'll start with electrostatics and isolated charges and what are Coulombic forces and the inverse square law and the vector form of Coulomb's law. So basically, we'll just do a basic amount of recap in the first 5 minutes. Then we want to move on to the much more advanced topics of multiple superposition of charges and the physical significance of relative permittivity and a basic idea of electric fields. Now we start with this topic of electrostatics. So, if we take two isolated point charges, we know that two charges can be isolated in nature. It is unlike magnetic fields, magnetic poles, North Pole or the South Pole, where you can't isolate magnetic North Pole or South Pole. We can isolate a positive charge and a negative charge. So, if we take a positive charge and a negative charge, or as a matter of fact, any two charges, and place them at a radial distance r apart, mind it, this should be two point charges, plus and a plus and a minus separated by the radial distance r, separated by a radial distance r. We name this as q1 and we give this name a q2. Mind it, it can be two positive charges, it can be a pair of two negative charges, as well as it can be a positive charge and a negative charge. So basically this is a two charge or a two point system. So q1 and q2, fine. Now this is separated by this vector r12, fine, r12 cap, and or vice versa, the r21 cap. Mind the force will be attractive or repulsive depending on the nature of the charges. If both are positive or both of negative, that means they are like charges, they will repel each other. And if both of them are positive and a negative charge, it will obviously attract each other. So if we do a basic recap what sir did in the last lecture, we'll see that F12 vector is given as 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q1 q2 by r12 square r12 cap. Now what is r12 cap? r12 cap is basically your unit vector. What is it? It's basically a unit vector. What is the significance of this unit vector? This unit vector, if we see this part is a vector quantity. This is a vector quantity. This is a vector. Fine. This part over here is only a magnitude. This part over here is the magnitude of the force. What is it? It's basically the magnitude of the force. Is basically the magnitude of the Coulombic force. Now since in the LHS we have a vector quantity, this is the magnitude, obviously the force should also have a direction. So this is basically r12 cap is basically signifies the direction of the force. Basically it signifies the direction of the force. So basically this is a vector and this is a vector. Now as you all know, if we do a basic recap of class 11, the basic preliminary lessons that you have learned, we know that a unit vector a cap is given by a vector by mod of that vector. A vector by the mod of that vector. Now, R12 cap can be written as R1 vector minus R2 vector by mod of R1 vector minus R2 vector. Now, if we take this and plug this over here, can you see this? This R1 vector minus R2 vector by mod of R1 minus R2. If we take it over here and plug it back over here, we see that the vector equation becomes 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1. R1 vector minus R2 vector. That is 1 by 4 pi F12 is given as Q1 Q2 by mod of R1 minus R2 whole cube, R1 vector minus R2 vector. This is basically your vector form of Coulomb's. Law's law. Now, so what is this direction? It's basically the radial separation between the two point charges. It acts along the radial separation, along the line joining the two charges. The force, this force acts along the line joining the two charges. So this is basically the recap of what you have done in your last class. Fine. So this is the entire Coulomb's law in the vector format that we have studied. Now we move on to today's lecture. What today's lecture basically starts off with a very simple thing, that do Coulombic forces obey Newton's third law of motion? So basically it will first prove it, that whether it obeys or it is in synergy with Newton's third law of motion. Fine. So let's do this. Basically this was just the recap of what you had done in your last lecture. Fine. F12 vector is given as 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Q2 by mod of R12 whole square R1 2 cap. Fine? Yes or no? If you draw these two charges over here, this is Q1, this is your Q2. This is your Q1, this is your Q2, this is your radial separation, R1 2 cap, or R2 1 cap. I'll explain this part just a second later. Let me write down the equations. F21, that is the force, this is the force on 1 due to 2, this is the force on 2 due to 1. So let us analyze what is the difference between these two equations. Let us simply analyze what is the difference between these two equations. See, the force on 1 due to 2 is basically Q1, Q2. This is the product of the two charges by the square of the radial separation, or the radial separation between the two charges. Now we know F21 is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, again the product of the two charges, by R21 mod square R21 cap. So basically the basic difference between these two equations is not in the magnitude of the Coulombic forces. Mind it, the magnitude lies over here. This entire part is your magnitude. See, there is no difference. R12 square is equal to mod R21 square, because this is just the separation between the two charges. Then what is different between these two equations? The basic difference between these two equations is in the direction. The force is the same. The force is the same, but the direction is just opposite in nature. If you see R12 cap, R21 cap, the basic difference is basically the change in the direction of the two of the direction of the forces. That is, while one attracts or repels in one direction, the other simultaneously attracts or repels in the other direction. That is, if we do it mathematically or the vectorically, we get R12 cap is equal to minus R21 cap. R12 cap is equal to minus R21 cap. So I repeat again, the magnitude of the Coulombic forces remains the same. It is only in the direction of the two forces that the forces are opposite in nature. So we can say from the magnitude part that it is equal, but it is in opposite in direction. From this relation R12 cap and minus R21 cap, we can directly conclude that F12 vector is nothing but minus of F21 vector, where mod of F12 is equal to mod of F21. Mind it, this mod of F12 is equal to mod of F21 signifies that the Coulombic forces are equal in magnitude. The force exerted on Q2 due to Q1 is magnitude same as that on the force exerted on Q1 due to Q2. But what is the basic difference? The basic difference lies in the fact that the direction are just opposite in nature. So we can conclude that Newton's third law of motion is observed in this case. Newton's third law of motion is obeyed in this case. Fine? Okay. Now let's move on to the next part of our lecture. What is the significance of this epsilon naught? What is the significance of, or we can write it as significance of what is the significance of epsilon naught? We see that epsilon naught is given as relative or absolute. If it's epsilon, it's the relative, it's epsilon naught, the permittivity of free space. It's known as permittivity of free space. Now, what is the value of epsilon naught is given as epsilon naught equal to 8.854 10 to the power minus 12 Coulombic square Newton minus 1 meter to the power minus 2. So this is basically a value that's present in all the standard textbooks at all levels, wherever you study electrostatics. But more than this value, what is the basic significance of epsilon naught or the permittivity of free space? The physical significance of permittivity of free space, or the absolute permittivity of free space, let us do the relative permittivity of free space, is now we'll discuss with the absolute permittivity of free space, is basically that what is the capability of vacuum or this space to allow the electric field lines, which I'll discuss later, to pervade through that space, free space? How much will the electric field lines penetrate or pervade through that free space? If this is your free space, or a matter of fact, any material, or a matter of fact, any material will replace epsilon naught with epsilon over there, that becomes a relative permittivity. Okay, on that case, but what is the basic physical significance? That is of utmost concern to us. This value is just a magnitude value, it's written in the standard textbooks, but what we have to get or to understand is basically, what is the significance of epsilon naught? It is basically linked to two or three factors. I'll explain the first factor, but as we go on moving with the lectures in the next classes, you'll also learn about those factors. The first factor or the basic factor is how free or how capable is the substance or the vacuum allowing it to pervade through free space, the electric field lines. The electric field lines, how well can it penetrate through those materials? It's given by this epsilon, or the measure of that. This is an abstract quantity, right? Those are the magnitude or the quantitative measure is given by this epsilon naught. Later on, you'll also see that the energy stored in any particular electric field is also given by or is also measured by this factor of epsilon of the energy stored in a capacitor. So basically, at this starting juncture, we'll say that the free space, the how capable is the free space or the vacuum able to permit or pervade the electric field lines through that free space. So that is basically the relative or the physical significance of epsilon naught. Now we come to the next part. We all know that this is a very interesting part. We all know that Newton discovered gravity, and he proved it or experimentally proved it to be an inverse square law. Now, what is inverse square law? An inverse square law is basically a law where the force varies as inversely proportional to the square of the radial separation of the body. I repeat, it's a force where the force or the magnitude of the force varies as inversely proportional to the square of the radial separation. So Newton showed this, that F or inverse square law are those forces that varies as 1 by R square, where F directly proportional to 1 by R square. Now nature strikes a symmetry. Nature strikes a symmetry, and we find out that both the gravitational forces as well as the Coulombic forces both follow the inverse square law principle. Now, what is gravitational forces? We have done the gravitational forces in class 11. We'll do a short recap of that. Let there be two masses, M1 and M2. Now, if there are two masses, M1 and M2, separated by this radial separation, we get the gravitational force Fg as G, this is R, M1, M2 by R square. There is a minus sign in front. What is the significance of this minus sign? The significance of this minus sign is that force is attractive in nature. This is basically for the vector part. But we'll basically now deal with the magnitude part. That is of our concern or interest at this moment. So Fg is given as minus G M1 M2 by R square. Now, this is gravitational force. This is your gravitational force. Now, we write electrostatic force. We take two charges, Q1 and Q2. We take two charges, Q1 and Q2, radially separate them. Radially separate them. Then what do we get? We get something like this. F12 given by minus, if it's a proton and a neutron, the attraction or the repulsion is not uniform in case of gravitation, is given by, if I take one to be a proton and one to be an electron, the force will be attractive in nature. It's 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, Q1, Q2 by R square. Q1, Q2 by R square. Now we need to do some brute calculations, just plugging in values. I'll just directly plug in the values because it's just calculation and nothing else. Now, if you take the ratio, if this is a proton, in the gravitation case, if it's a proton and an electron, we'll see that taking ratio of 1 versus 2, this is 1, this is 2, E. That is electronic charge on in the back. Something of the order of 2.4, I'll write it in a different color. 2.4 into 10 to the power 39. 2.4 into 10 to the power 39. We get something of the order 2.4 into 10 to the power 39. Now, see this, obviously it's, the ratio is both of forces, so it's unitless. So now let us do a special case. Now if you do the same thing for two protons, this is for a proton and an electron. If you do the same thing for two protons, let's analyze the situation. Let's analyze the situation on an internuclear situation where there are two protons. We'll compare the gravitational forces of two protons inside the atomic nucleus. Suppose this is my nucleus. This is just a rough estimate for your rough calculations. Okay, this is just a rough estimate. Nucleus, there are two protons. And experimentally we have taken that to be 10 to the separation between two protons to be 10 to the power minus 15 meters. We have experimentally taken, or the From experiments, it is revealed that R is 10 to the power minus 15 meters. Similarly, for two protons, what will it be? F, electrostatics. Mind it, there won't be any negative sign now because two protons will obviously repel each other. Q1, Q2 by R square. So 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. Now we do the same thing for the case of gravitation. G, we get mass of two protons by R square. So if you take a calculator or sit impatiently and calculate these individual values, I'll just write down the values. We'll see that the electrostatic force is of the order of 230 newtons. Is of the order of 230 newtons, where in the case of the gravitational force, it takes around 1.9 into 10 to the power minus 34 Newton. So we are done with the brute calculations now. We'll understand the significance or the physics behind this. This is brute calculations. You just have to plug in 10 to the power minus 15. You have to plug in 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulombs over here. Sit a bit patiently. Calculate or compute this, all these things. So finally, we land up with something as 230 newtons. Mind you, this is 230 newtons. This is of the order of 230 newtons, where this is of the order of 10 to the power minus 34 newtons. As evident, as clear, as basic mathematics states, that Fe is very, very, very much greater than Fg. That the force of electron is very much, very much greater than the gravitational force. That is one of the main reasons that the protons are stable inside a nucleus. That is one of the main reasons for the protons being stable inside the nucleus. Mind it, what is the basic difference between this electrostatic? This is when we compare the magnitudes. The electrostatic force is far, far, far greater than the... of one, whatever, suppose he gives an answer, doesn't affect the answer of the other person. If suppose the teacher asks him a question, and so is taken. If there are, say, and individually, they ask this case or a situation. But individually, in charge of answers, mandate, the answer of one person, the answer of one person doesn't affect the answer of the other person. But as the teacher, we always take the cumulative response of the entire class. So, basically, if we move on to the charge, in the case of the charges, what will happen is basically, suppose there are n charges. We take a vector or a reference frame of xy or an xy plane. We take an xy plane. Now there are n number of charges that are located over here. There are n number of charges located over here, and our objective is basically to this is joined by a radius vector r1, this is joined by a radius vector r2, this is joined by a radius vector r3 dot dot, and this is by rn vector. Okay. So, I'll tell you the mathematics, I'll explain the mathematics later, but before that, let me tell a little bit about what does this mean. There should be a test charge and there should be a source charge. What is a test charge and a source charge? Test charge is the charge. Test charge is the charge on which we'll feel the effect of the other charges. Test charge, you can assign any of them as any test charge. You can assign any of them. There are some criteria of making a test charge, but we'll put that later for the future discussion. But we can assume any one of them as the test charge. In our case, let us assume that the test charge is Q1. It can be taken any charge over here, okay? This is test charge and this is the source charge. So what are the source charges? First, what is our objective? Our objective is basically to find the force or the vector or the force on Q1 due to the charges Q2, Q3, Q4, Q5, dot dot up to Qn. I repeat once again. What is our main objective? Our main objective is basically to find the force on Q1 due to the charge Q2, Q3, Q4, dot dot up to Qn. So what is then our test charge? Then what is the test charge? So we have assumed this to be the test charge. Test charge is the charge on which we are testing the effect of all the other charges or the forces on this test charge, Q1. Now, so what are the source charges? In this case, Q2, Q3, Qn. Q2, Q3, dot dot up to Qn. Now, basically, before we jump into the mathematics, let's explain the physics behind it. Physics says that the principle of superposition says that principle of superposition says that the sum of the vector sum or Q2, the force on Q1 due to Q2, will be independent of the force on Q1 due to Q3, and henceforth on the force on Q1 will be due to on the, because of Qn will be independent of all the other charges. I repeat once more that the force that Q2 exerts on Q1 is independent of the force that Q3 exerts on Q1, which is in further independent of all the forces that Qn exerts on Q1. So basically, All of them are independent. But if we find the net force, we have to find the net force at this point x. We have to add them vectorically. Mind it, we have to add them vectorically. Why do you have to add them vectorically? The common mistakes that people make, people just add them in the scalar way. They just simply add them, all the forces are to be added. Mind it, these are all vector quantities of different magnitudes and different directions. When directions comes into play, we have to add them vectorically. So if you have to add them vectorically, what do we do now? We have to move on to something known as a displacement vector. We go back to class 11 and then do a bit recap of what is a displacement vector. Suppose there are two points over here. This is geometry. This is R1 vector. This is R2 vector. So if you go by the triangle law of addition, we know that R2 vector plus R vector is equal to R1 vector. R2 vector plus R vector is given as R1 vector. So R vector is equal to R1 vector minus R2 vector. We call this as the displacement vector, or the vector joining these two points. We call this as the displacement vector. So we can also name it as R1 2 cap. Fine. So we join these lines. Mind it, we'll write these things over here. R1 2 cap is given as R1 minus R2 vector by obviously mod of R1 minus R2. Similarly, R13 is given as R1 minus R3 mod of R1 minus R2. Fine. We go by R1n. That is the radial separation between the first charge, that is the source charge, the test charge, and the effect of the charge that is placed on the nth charge. That is R1 vector minus Rn vector by mod of R1 minus Rn. R1 vector minus Rn vector by mod of R1 minus Rn. So now, if you look at this point, so what will be F12? I'll take K as 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. So I don't have to plug 1 by 4 pi epsilon at each and every point. K is just the constant, the abbreviation of the constant or the symbol of the constant 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. Q1, Q2 by R12 square R1 2 cap. F13, that is force exerted on the charge 1 or the test charge 1 due to 3, is given as K Q1 Q2 by R13 square R13 cap. Now if you proceed in this way, what do we get? F, hope it's legible now, F1n K Q1 Q2 by R1n square R1n cap. Fine. So F12 is K Q1 Q2 R12 square R12 cap. F13 is K Q1 Q3 and this is Q1 Qn, sorry. It's Q1, this is Q3. Q1 Qn R1 square R1n cap. This is all written in terms of unit vectors. See, F12, that is force on 1 due to the charge 2 is given as K Q1 Q2 by R12 square R12 cap. F13 is given as K Q1 Q3 R13 square R13 cap. If we go on this symmetry, we write F1n, that is force on 1 due to the nth charge, is given as K Q1 Qn by R1 n square, that is basically the radial separation, this is displacement vector. How do we get this displacement vector? From the triangle law of addition. By basically just following the triangle law of addition as the pointer goes, if you see the pointer, this is the triangle law of addition. This is the triangle law of addition. We have just taken this triangle, we have marked this So k q1 q2 qn by r1 n square and into r1 n cap. Now we have to find the net force at this point. We have to find the net force on q1. That is the net force. Now we see that all of them are vector quantities. We see that all of them are vector quantities. So basic logic says, or vector algebra says, that all of them have to be added vectorically. All of them have to be added vectorically. So net force on Q1 is given by F1, 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, or we'll write it later. F12 vector plus F13 vector plus F13 vector, F13 vector plus F1n vector. So we see that all these forces over here, all these forces over here are added vectorically. F12 vector plus F13 vector plus F1n vector. So if we plug back these values, from where do we get these values? We get this value from here. We take these values and just simply plug it back over here. We get something of this sort. 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, we take it as common. Q1 is common. See, Q1, the source charge, the test charge, sorry, the test charge is Q1 is common in all the cases. See, Q1, Q1, Q1. So I can easily take them as common. So what is varying? We see that the source charge is varying. And mind it, when we are adding this, we see that they're all independent of each other. That this force is not masking the effect of this force. Neither is any one of this force masking the effect or shielding the effect of this force. So they're in mutual synergy. They're in mutual coexisting. So basically they're mutually, we can add them vectorically. Nowhere is this force, mind it, this is the cream of the principle of superposition, is that nowhere this force masks or shields the effect of this force on charge Q1, neither does any one of the forces mask or shields the effect of the other forces on the charge Q1. Fine. So we can easily take Q1 and 4 pi epsilon common. We plug this back over here. Q2 R12 square R12 cap. Fine. Next, Q3 by R13 square R13 cap, and if you extend it to nth number, I hope you see, Qn R1n square R1 n cap. Fine. So we see what? That all of the, see, this is a vector quantity to the left. There's a vector quantity to the left. And now all of these are vector quantities. So what are we having? We see that this force doesn't affect this force. Neither does this force affect any other terms. So these are all independent terms. These are all independent terms acting on Q1. These are all individual forces acting on Q1. But to get the net resultant force, you get the net resultant force over here. See the pointer, the net resultant force over here, we have to add them. We have to add them vectorically because vector is involved. Now, we can also write this, we can also write this in terms of summation as Q1 by 1 by Q1, 4 pi epsilon naught. Now, this is the summation sign. This is the summation sign. We go in a loop. What? We start in with I is equal to 2. Why don't we start with I is equal to 1? This is the most important case. See, over here, why don't we start with I is equal to 1? Because I myself, if I am a charge, I cannot exert force on myself. Right? We need a pair of charges. I myself can never exert a force on myself if I am a charge. So, Q1, so I starts from 2. The combination that we take starts from 2.
But if you, as a matter of fact, we have designated any other, we have designated any other charge as a test charge, we have to leave the charge, because a charge can never exert a coulombic force on itself. So it starts from 2. So this is the takeaway from this part. The takeaway from this part, or the summation sign, is this I is equal to 2. Why does this I is equal to 2 start? I starts from I is equal to 2 because the force, if we are supposed to find Q1, a force on Q1, we can never have something, a force exerting on itself. A force, a charge can never exert on its, a force on itself. So is we start from I is equal to 2. I is equal to 1 is left, because this is my test. This is, we have designated this as the test charge. We have designated this as the test charge. Now, so it's clear? Because, so we start with I is equal to 2, we run to N. We run to N, because there are N number of charges. That's, so it goes something like this. Qi R 1i square R 1i cap. So I is equal to 2 to N. So it reiterated this. So what happens when I is equal to 2? So Q1, Q2, R12 square. So this is basically this term, right? This term. Now the loop goes to 3. I goes to 3. That becomes what? Q1, 4 pi epsilon naught, Q3, R13 square, R13 cap. This is your this term. So now if you move on to the last term, when I becomes N, Q1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, Q1, R1N square, R1N cap. So it becomes much more crisp, much more fine, and we can clearly understand that no charge can. So what is the takeaway from this net thing? What is the takeaway from this net lecture? The takeaway from this thing is that no charge affects the effect or the force, affects the force or mask or shields the force exerted on another charge due to the other charge, right? So basically, if I have to reframe it or rephrase it, so Q2 or Q3 or Qn are independent. The force exerted by them on Q1 is independent. Nowhere does Q2 mask the effect of Q3. Neither does Q3 affect the mask of Q2 on Q1. But we have to vectorically add them to find the net force. One, this is one case. And from the last line, what do we take away? This is just a mathematical crisp form of writing it. But it also has a takeaway when you write I is equal to 2. What is the takeaway from this point? The takeaway from I is equal to 2 is basically very simple. The takeaway from I is equal to 2 is that no charge can exert an electrostatic force on itself. Now we move on to a very basic point, or the last portion of the lecture. We'll start briefly. What is an electric field? An electric field is basically the force on an unit charge. The force on an unit charge. We'll just end the lecture with just a basic definition of the electric field. So this is the source charge. This is the source charge. Now this is the point where I have to find the force. So this source charge is having some effect on this point, or an electrostatic effect on this point, yes or no? Either it is attracting or it is repelling, depending on the nature of the charge placed on P, on the nature of the charges. Either it is attracting or repelling, depending on the nature of the charges. If you place a unit positive charge over here, a unit charge over, or the source charge, so it will repel. If you place two charges of two opposite magnitudes, what will happen? They will attract. If you place two opposite charges, then it will either attract, and if it is of the opposite side, they will, of the same charge, it will repel. Now, suppose electric field is defined as the force per unit charge. Force per unit charge. So the moment we divide Q, this is Q, this is small q, this is your test charge. And this is your source charge. This is your source charge. So the moment you divide it with by Q, what will happen? It becomes independent of the test charge. It becomes independent of the test charge. This means what? That source charge and this charge P and this point P, whatever charge you take, whatever charge you take at the source charge, the electric field because of this source charge will always remain same. You can always change this test charge. It is for a unit charge. It is for a unit charge, will the electric field be something for the source charge? So an electric field is totally dependent on the source charge. Totally dependent on the Now you have to find the force. What is the force? We can now bring in any amount of test charge and it will be given as F is equal to QE. F is equal to QE. That is for an unit charge, it is E. For an unit charge, it is E. So it is totally, the moment you divide this, you make it independent of the test charge. The moment you divide this, you make it independent of the test charge. Now it is because of this source charge, there's an electric field over there. Now you have to find the magnitude of force. What is the force that the source charge is acting over there? For unit charge, it is E. Now for Q amount of charge, it will become QE. So this is the very preliminary basic definition of an electric field. It will be covered in the next lectures. And if you take it in the lines of calculus, it becomes something like this. Our objective is to make the test charge as small as possible. We have to make the test charge to make it independent in terms of physical sense. In terms of physics, or you have to get the physical significance of this, we have to make this as small as possible to get that the electric field, because force will be measured. Force will be measured. To get the electric field, we have to make the test charge as small as possible. Fine. So if we have to revert back to the electric field, just multiply the test charge with the electric field. So this brings us to the end of this lecture. So what are the topics that we covered today? The topics that we covered today is basically a recap of Vekulov's vector's law, the principle of superposition, the comparison of gravitational force and electrostatic force, where we have seen that the electrostatic force is far, far, far greater in magnitude as that of the gravitational force. The Coulombic force is far, far greater than the gravitational force. The nature of attraction and the nature of repulsion, depending on the charges, there is two positive charges where two like charges repel, whereas two unlike charges attract each other. And obviously we have also studied the principle of superposition, where we have also studied the significance of relative permittivity of free, or the absolute permittivity of free space. So basically epsilon naught, where the capability of material or the vacuum to allow electric field to pass through it. Then we have briefly studied about the principle of superposition. Principle of superposition, as we know, as states that no charge will mask or shield the effect of the other charge on a particular point. Then we have briefly gone through the electric field, or what is the electric field, and the basic significant definition of electric field, that is independent of the test charge and it completely depends on the source charge. So, and to revert it back to the force, just have to multiply the test charge with it. Thank you. Have a nice day.